Session today with the contributed talks, the short talks, and we are on the channel dedicated for this session. It's hashtag day 3, 30 September talks AM. We have four presentations in this session, and as usual, please type in your comments into the channel and tag the in the place that's designated for those questions. And our first presenter is Ashwin Vishwanathan. Ashwin's previous research has mostly focused on plant ecology in the Western Ghats and Northeast India, but over the past few years, he's increasingly become aware of the power and possibilities of citizen science, mostly because of his long-term interest in bird watching. So he currently works with BirdCon India at the Education and Public Engagement Program at NCF. BirdCon India works with bird watchers and nature groups across the country to effectively monitor and generate knowledge about India's birds. And Ashwin will be talking about the state of India's birds, and over to his video.
Hello all, I will be speaking to you about the state of India's birds, a report that was released in February this year. So unlike parts of North America and Europe, India did not have any systematic assessment of its birds. And such assessments are important because they help inform conservation action and which species to prioritize while taking any conservation forward. So this was mainly because India did not have any long-term data set of its birds. But this changed in has changed in the last few years. And data set began to emerge because of observations that bird watchers uploaded to a platform called eBird. So bird watchers started uploading this information in 2014, many amazing people went back to their old notebooks that were lying at home and uploaded checklists and their bird observations from all the way back from 1960s and the 1970s. So what this produced was a long-term data set. And something perhaps that finally allowed an assessment of this kind to take place. So what you see on this map here is not the political boundary of India drawn out, but it's actually all of these observations that have that span the entire length and breadth of the country, and therefore makes it appear that this is actually the political boundary. So there are many million observations now, and of over 1,000 species. 10 organizations decided to capitalize on this data set finally becoming available, and decided to analyze it to come out with long-term trends, range size, and conservation status of 867 bird species in India. But how can trends be derived from such a data set? So first, I'll take you through what an eBird checklist looks like. This is a typical eBird checklist from Dehradun of 16 species. There is some time, there is a duration, and there's a number of observers and some very important information about whether it is complete or not complete. Now, using a checklist of this kind, a metric called frequency of reporting can be derived. So I'll explain why frequency of reporting is something like abundance later, but frequency of reporting is basically derived like this. Say you have five species, five checklists and five species. Species A was reported in five out of five checklists, which means that its frequency of reporting was 100%. Whereas species C over here was reported only in two out of five checklists, which means that its frequency of reporting was 40%. Now, this frequency of reporting, if that is this is followed over time, what you get is some idea of whether the species is increasing, decreasing, or remaining stable. But eBird data is not systematically collected, and therefore there are lots of biases that need to be statistically controlled for before any inferences can be drawn. So one of these biases is a variable effort across checklists. Checklists can go from 5 minutes to many hours long. It can vary from a stationary checklist at one point to something that covers many tens of kilometers. So there needs to be a way to average across this. So that is what we do statistically, standardized to to a checklist of average effort. Another bias in eBird data is seasonal. There are many checklists that are made during winter, maybe not so many that are made during summer in the monsoon where it's hot or raining. So there needs to be a way to standardize across this, because otherwise species frequencies of reporting will be biased. So it's standardized to average month. And then perhaps most importantly, we do not want a single place, even if it's very heavily birded, to bias the trend for a species. So Bangalore has a lot of checklists, lots of bird watchers, but we don't want the trend of a species to reflect its trend in Bangalore. So it's important to average across space. So this was done by gridding the country into 125 kilometer grids, and we averaged across those grids using a generalized mixed effects framework. I can take questions about this if required. With all of this and this long-term data set, we managed to calculate frequency of reporting for 10 different time intervals, and then follow this frequency of reporting over time to get a long-term trend. So this before 2000 was the first large interval which contains some amount of data till 2018. So I'll start off with house sparrow. House sparrow, the general perception is that it has declined considerably. But what we found is that actually house sparrow is stable in the country as a whole. The y-axis here tells you the change in this abundance index, the change in frequency of reporting as a percentage over time. So here you see that it hasn't changed much, so it's at 0%, whereas redneck falcon has declined by more than 50%. Ashiprinia has increased by almost 100%, which makes sense because it follows any kind of degradation. But house sparrow has declined in big cities, something I wanted to make clear, although it has remained stable in the country as a whole. I also want to say that vultures give this analysis more support, because the results that we got in State of Birds almost exactly mirrors what independent assessments have found, because vultures are charismatic species that are well studied. So you find that white rump vulture has declined the most, followed by Indian vulture, followed by Egyptian vulture. There are also some global insights that we get. For example, Pacific golden plover, which is an Arctic breeder, declined in Singapore to almost 0% of what it was previously, and our trends in India almost mirror that exactly, which means that Arctic migrants, many of them are in grave peril at the moment. So to summarize, there were 58 species that had strong declines in their long-term trends, 72 species that are in strong decline today in terms of their current trends, and all of these were put together with rain size to give a category of conservation concern for every species. So there are 101 species that are of high concern, and these are the species that the report suggests are prioritized for conservation in India. Thank you.
Okay, thanks a lot, Ashwin, for that talk. We have a fair bit of time for questions because it was relatively short talk. I think I don't at the moment see any questions. Oh, there we got some questions.
There are some questions.
So one question that Robin asks is, how much change does there need to be to classify a species as changed? For example, decline or strong decline or unable to assess? And how does it relate to the original sample size?
Ashwin, Ashwin for that talk. We have a fair bit of time.
Okay. So, can I start answering questions?
Yeah, go ahead. Yeah.
Oh, okay. So I'll start off with Robin's question.
Oh, sorry. did you hear me? I read out Robin's question, but maybe there was some.
Okay.
Yeah.
Sorry, I think I missed it.
Okay, let me read it out again. Sorry about this. How much change does there need to be for you to make a decision about change versus unable to assess? And how does that relate to the original sample sizes?
Right. So the criteria we use to decide whether a species has changed, whether it's in strong decline or moderate decline, or whether it has increased, is based on some of these other assessments and the criteria they've used in other parts of the world to allow this to be standard to an extent. So many of these other assessments, like state of North America's birds, and some assessments in Europe use this 50% and 25% as criteria. So anything greater than 50% decline would be a strong decline. And now, to be conservative, we have tried to incorporate all the uncertainty we have in the assessment into these criteria. So for example, in our case, in the graphs I showed, you must have noticed the shaded areas, which indicate the amount of uncertainty there was in that estimate. So now the top and the higher level of confidence and the lower level of confidence would both have to be less than 50% for something to be in strong decline. So something, if the estimate was minus 75 plus or minus 20%, that would mean that the entire range of confidence is below 50%. Or greater than 50% decline. So in which case it would be in strong decline.
Okay, I'm sure there's a lot more nuance that which you can also respond to and comment in Slack. There's a question by Paul on how you averaged efforts across cells or grids using GLM, and how does that affect the trend projections for individual cells? Maybe Ashwin, there's probably a lot of technical detail there, but possible to give just an overview and then maybe respond in detail on Slack?
Yes, I'll do that. And just to complete my answer to Robin's question, yes, the sample sizes play a role, because the greater the sample size, the lower the uncertainty. So more likely to have certain assessments with larger sample sizes. And going to Paul's question, So, this was done using a GLM, and this was done with what are called random effects, where these random effects were specified so that there would be some manner of averaging over space, so that a particular space doesn't get a particular grid unit in the country doesn't get any more weightage than some other grid unit that is not so well sampled. So I'll respond in more detail in Slack, but broadly, yeah, this is how it was done. Richard, okay, yeah.
Okay, that's great. I'm going to skip over some questions which are not specifically about your work that you've spoken about. Ankit asks, what was the total number of grids in the study and how did you decide on the size of the grids for the model?
Yeah, that's a great question. The size was decided based on our understanding of how precise eBird data is. How precise reporting is on the eBird platform. So from our general understanding of how bird watchers make their checklists, a large number of checklists are at reasonably fine resolutions, for example, over a kilometer or 2 kilometers or even stationary. But especially data from the past or data from more remote parts of the country are often in, say, tens of kilometers, 20, 30, sometimes even 50 kilometers. So there had to be a trade-off in terms of how much and how precise we could have these how precise the data we included in the assessment was going to be, and in how much of reach, how much of the country we were going to cover. So this compromise led us to 25 and 25 kilometers as being the minimum resolution, because if we went any further in some remote parts of the country, we are losing important data. So all of the data, of course, was also filtered to this level before analysis.
Great, thank you. Chayant has a question about, are there certain common features between species that have declined? And are there any particular traits that correspond with the trend in species decline or increase?
Thanks, Chayant. Yeah, that's something that I did not include. I was hoping to get to that in questions, so thanks for this. There are some groups of species that have declined more than others. For example, we see a clear trend in terms of species that depend upon grasslands or grassland habitats. So this is both in terms of passerines and other groups that depend on grasslands, and raptors, that birds of prey that depend upon grasslands. So we find that these habitat specialists are declining. Raptors as a group are also showing declines, and this is in keeping with our understanding of how raptors, because of their high position on the food chain, are generally more threatened than others. So these are some broad trends, but one thing that really has made an impression on me, what's happening to Arctic breeding shorebirds, these long distance migrants that breed in the Arctic. And our understanding from studies back in their breeding ranges is that these species have declined, are showing strong declines. But of course, these assessments haven't been done across the entire breeding range. So what this state of birds has given us an insight into is what's possibly happened to populations of shorebirds that breed in a region which hasn't been so well studied so far in the Arctic, some parts of Russia that fall in the Central Asian Flyway mostly. And it appears that these Arctic migrants are declined by 70-80%, really worrying declines. And if you compare that with shorebirds that do not migrate such long distances and do not face the threats of climate change, for example, that Arctic breeders face, some of those like wood sandpiper, green sandpiper, black-tailed godwit, etc., have declined far less. And resident shorebirds like little ring plover and Kentish plover and some of these other species have hardly shown any decline. So there's a clear trend that the more northern your breeding area, the more you're likely to have declined.
Okay, thanks, Ashwin. We have just a minute or so. So just one last question, which is a Robin's question, follow-up to Chayant's. Is there any, what's the pattern in data availability? Are there any particular habitats or species groups that are better covered than others?
Yes. There are some parts of the country which haven't been so well covered. For example, a few parts of Northeast India, some of the less accessible areas, some parts of the Gangetic Plains, some parts of Bihar, some parts of Jharkhand, Orissa, etc. But this report or the assessments over here, it includes data from a large part of the country, but not the entire country. So hoping that the next assessment will be even more comprehensive in terms of coverage than it is now. And we've already seen since the report has come out that bird watchers have been active in many parts of the country which did not feature so much in the report itself. So the next one, I think, is going to be far more comprehensive.
Great. Thanks a lot, Ashwin. And there are more questions on the chat. So if you can please respond to those and give any more details to add to what you responded already, that will be very nice. Thanks again. So we